Good afternoon, everyone, and a very warm welcome to our event on the IPCC report and the role of carbon capture and utilization, CCU, to mitigate climate change. So today we're going to have a wide range of scientists and speakers to present the different subjects related to CCU in the IPCC report. So here you see the agenda. So I will start with an introduction on the role of CCU in the IPCC report. Then we will continue with Dr. Deepak Pant on the state of the art of the CCU technology. So where do we stand today in terms of CCU technologies? Then we will continue on the role of CCU in the energy systems, and then speak on the role of CCU in the building sector, and then on the chemical industry. So how CO₂ can be used as a feedstock there. Then we will have a first Q&A with this first panel. And then we will continue, have a coffee break, and I will present the second part later on. So let's start with the hard part of the subject. So carbon capture and utilization and its role to mitigate climate change. For the very first time, the IPCC has recognized CCU as a solution to mitigate climate change in the six assessment reports that has been published recently. So this report is in three working groups. So we have a first working group that was published in August last year, which really represents the scientific, the physical basis on climate change. So what is happening now with our climate systems due to climate human-induced climate change. The second report that was published in February concerns the impacts of this climate change and also the vulnerability and the risk, and what are the measures that we need to implement to adapt to these risks. And the third report that has been published like a few weeks ago on climate change mitigation, so on the solutions. And it's in this third report that carbon capture and utilization is considered as a solutions amongst other solutions. So for those who do not know very well the IPCC, so it's the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. So it's an intergovernmental body of the United Nations, and it provides objective and comprehensive scientific information on human-induced climate change, including the natural, political, and economic impact and risks, and also the possible response options, the possible solutions. To give you some numbers, so the IPCC is composed of 195 member states. They sit in plenaries where all decisions are taken in consensus. So for example, about the outlines of the report, of the authors that are nominated, etc. And the first assessment report was published in 1990 already, so it's quite back in the time. And the main messages were relatively similar than the message we have today in this six assessment report, except that now the uncertainty is much lower and the messages are also much stronger. In terms of this third working group on climate mitigation, there were more than 600 international authors from 65 countries that have contributed to this report. It's a report of more than 3,000 pages. And there were 18,000 scientific publications that have been assessed. So the authors are not doing research for the IPCC. They are really assessing all the research and scientific publications, especially peer-reviewed publications, and they bring them in the report. And in this 3,000 pages, there is also a summary for policymakers that is much shorter, and that is quite, it's really a summary of the key messages dedicated to the policymakers, and a technical summary that is about 145 pages that is also with the key messages, but in a more technical way. I really invite you to have a look there because it's well explained and you have the key messages really summarized well. But there were also about 60,000 comments during the expert review. So this report was first published as a first draft, and there were a first review, and then the comments were implemented, and then there were a second release of the second draft. And then again, we could do an expert review on this. And together with the Scientific Advisory Committee of CO₂ Value Europe, we have brought all the scientific literature related to CCU to the IPCC report, and we are very glad to see that this year, in this report, for the first time, CCU is covered there. So if we look at the general message of this third working group, it shows clearly that mitigation pathways exist to limit warming to 1.5 or 2 degrees, but this involves deep, rapid, and sustained emission reductions. So net zero greenhouse gas emissions is only possible through systemic climate mitigation actions and at all levels of the society. So I think this is really the key message of this report. And why do we always speak about this 1.5 degree or well below 2 degrees? It's because it is this at this temperature, or if we go above this temperature, that we have risk to reach tipping points where our climate system is going to become more and more uncontrolled, I would say, and where the life on Earth will be more and more degraded. So we will absolutely have to do everything we can to limit the global temperature increase to 1.5 degrees, or at least well below 2 degrees, and every tenth of degrees counts there. So on the general message, so the good news is that it's clearly stated that solutions currently exist and in all sectors to at least halve greenhouse gas emissions by 2030, which is the ultimate goal. And solutions should be based on sobriety, but also on energy efficiency and on circularity of goods, waste, and resources. Action will cost a lot of money, but it will cost far less to act than not to act. And as early we start, less it will cost in money, but also in human life, in health issues, and in discomfort. In terms of solutions, they have also shown, and I think this is also for the first time that it's so clearly explained in the IPCC, that cooperation, partnerships, but also industrial symbiosis and intersectoral cooperation and coordinations are the keys to success. So we should not see solutions as one sectors, but when we speak about carbon neutrality, we should really think about intersectorial approach. There is enough capital globally to take the proper measures to mitigate climate change, but the money flows towards the transitions should be multiplied by 3 to 6. And one very clear message also that is that clear, I think also for the first time in an IPCC report, is that no more investment on fossil carbon infrastructure are compatible with reaching climate objectives. So it means that we have an urgent need for more low carbon energy sources, but also for alternative carbon feedstock, so alternative to fossil. So there is a growing interest, if we look at all the research and the different studies that have been published, in circular carbon economy, wherein CO2 is converted into reusable materials. So this is especially relevant for the transitions of economies that are clearly dependent on fossil revenues. And it's also important when we think about becoming more sovereign in energy, especially with the different crises we are facing at the moment. So in this goal, carbon capture and utilizations play a very important part of the game. So carbon capture and utilization is a fact to capture CO2 or directly from the air or from the flue gas, and to convert the CO2 using renewable electricity into different types of materials. So we have building materials where CO2 can be stored permanently. We will discuss about it later on, but also the different power to X approach where CO2 can be converted into renewable chemicals and to renewable fuels. Here I've put the definitions of CCU from the IPCC glossary. So they insist on the fact that the climate effect of CCU depends on the product lifetime, the product it displays, and the CO2 sources. So if it's fossil, biomass or biogenic, or if it's coming from the atmosphere. I give two examples of CCU pathways. Here is on the CCO2 to renewable fuels and chemicals. So we can use renewable electricity and water and make electrolysis. So to break the water molecules into oxygen and hydrogen to create renewable hydrogen, which is by itself also a synthetic fuel. But as it's not easy to store, and we will discuss about that also later, we can make this hydrogen react with CO2 or from the air or from flue gas to create a very wide range of products from renewable fuels and chemicals. This allows us to create renewable carbon feedstock to move away from fossil fuels. It's also allow us to facilitate renewable electricity, the uptake, the storage, and the transportations, especially the uptake in sectors that cannot use directly renewable electricity. And it allows to reduce CO2 emissions because we reuse this CO2 in the system to create fuels. Another example is the role of CO2 mineralization. So there we use industrial waste, construction waste, for example. We have gigatons of it in Europe, which are rich in minerals, rich in energy. And we use CO2 that we dissolve in water to create calcium carbonate. And with this calcium carbonate, we can create a broad range of materials, of building materials, for example, aggregates, and we can also substitute some part of the cement in some type of building materials to decrease the carbon footprint of the product. So in that case, we have, we have here a carbonation plant. So in place, originally to create building material, we use natural resources from quarries, so rocks, and then we burn them, we emit a lot of CO2, and then we can create cement and then concrete and other type of materials, and then it goes to waste. So the idea is that we reduce this waste and we reduce also the amount of material we need from quarries to really create a circular pattern to create to produce building materials. So this will be discussed later on by Paola. So if we go back to the key statements on CCU from the IPCC report, here I will first present the opportunities that are presented. So the first statement is on the fact that CCU is a drop-in solutions with limited new infrastructure needs, especially when we speak about the production of CO2-based fuels and feedstock. But CCU is also has a large potential to decouple chemical production from fossil resources. So when we use CO2 as a renewable carbon feedstock in the chemical industry, for example. And there is a study from Ketlone et al. That show that we could reach up to 3.5 gigatons of CO2 use equivalent in 2030. In terms of CCU technologies, some CCU technologies are already at a commercialization level, while others are still in the lab or in prototype or pilot phase. But this is moving very fast. A few years ago, it was really an emerging technology, but it's really moving very fast. And I think you will see that also in the coming presentations. And there are clearly strong interactive effects between the low carbon electrification, the switching to, for example, biomass and hydrogen, ammonia, but also to CO2-based fuel. So all these different subjects have to be considered all together. And CCU can provide CO2 removal, so CDR solutions, when atmospheric or biogenic CO2 is durably stored in products. So this is also a clear statement from the IPCC. If we look now at the challenges, one of them is that there might be a highly unpredictable competitions between fossil, biogenic, and direct air capture, so the different source of carbon, to provide chemical feedstock, material, and fuel needs. So that shows that it's very important to know also how the demand on these different products will evolve. So it's important to also do market investigations and understand the market penetration of these products. And CCU has been envisioned as part of the circular economy, but there are also conflicting expectations, especially when CCU is mixed with CCS. And we are strongly advocating for the fact that CCU and CCS should be considered differently, especially when it comes to policy making, because the needs and the challenges for the two sectors are also quite different. And when they are mixed, it often makes that CCU becomes less considered. When we speak about risk perceptions and public acceptance on CCU, what is clear now is that the general public does not know much about CCU, so it's very hard to know what is the public acceptance on CCU. There is a bit more studies on CCS, and CCS, especially in Germany, there were several cases where CCS plants have been refused, so because of a problem of public acceptance. So this is a work also that will be discussed by Catherine at the end of this event. And there is also an important point is that when assessing CCU technologies and the role on mitigating climate change, we sometimes have a very diversified list of outputs, because the methods that are used to assess the mitigation potential of CCU are also very diverse, and they are also sometimes not constrained the same way or not constrained enough, because carbon capture and utilization is not one type of technology, it's a very large type of technologies, and the sector is very, very, very wide. So there is also a very high granularity. And this is one reason also why CCU is not taking into account at the moment in climate scenarios, because it's very hard to model it. So, but what is very clear is that to be sure that a specific CCU technology, but not only the technology, but also the whole context where it is used, so the whole system, it is very important to determine this impact by life cycle analysis and in a systematic way. And we will have a presentation from Andrea just after the coffee break on that subject. So for now, thank you for your attention. And I remind you that you can go on our LinkedIn and on our Twitter to ask your questions. So you can just take a picture of these QR codes to ask questions. And then I will give you the floor to the first speaker of the day, Dr. Deepak Pant.